Here, as the Chief Executive Officer of Treasury Consulting PT Limited, which is a Singaporean multinational group. And today we are going to shoot up a video which is on SAP Treasury and Risk Management. Architecture of SAP Treasury and Risk Management, exactly how it works. You must be surprising to know that our YouTube channel is now the second largest YouTube channel on YouTube. We hold approximately 510 odd YouTube videos. And we are expected to cross approximately 600 videos in the next 3 months, and hopefully this journey will continue till thousands and thousands of video. But as you know that we don't wanted to make our YouTube channel a thematic in the sense like a channel which focuses on one thing. Without quoting the name, we have so many channels on YouTube who are pretty thematic, who are quoting on only one thing. It's right that they have their own way of looking at it. Our YouTube channel would be focusing on everything, because our YouTube channel is nothing but what exactly Treasury Consulting is all about. Now, Treasury Consulting is a very diversified company, well-established company, working good. It's a Singaporean-based company. We are looking forward to venture out into hardcore ERP business, which is Enterprise Resource Planning, which is SAP and Oracle, JD Edwards, Hyperion, and a lot of new things like. In that regards, today is a very important day, which is 31st May 2018, whereby we would be initiating our video on SAP Treasury and Risk Management, which is an architecture. We would also be linking this with our capabilities in foreign exchange, and you know our capabilities in foreign exchange. And also, the upcoming videos would be focusing about IHB, which is in-house banking. So we would be creating a video whereby Treasury Consulting would not only let people know how this exactly works, but would also let people know how in their system, using either SAP or Oracle or maybe different ERP, because there are multiple ERP packages, how you can create the in-house banking in your system. Before initiating this video, let me tell you one thing very clearly, that there is nothing uniformity as far as the SAP Treasury module is concerned, which is shortly known as TR module. You have a lot of modules like material management, ST, sales and distribution, which is FICO, financials and controlling. There are so many modules. The biggest difference between all these modules is that Treasury module do not have any standard procedures. Although this is just an introductory video about Treasury module, if you've been through the Treasury module, if you have any experience, then it varies from company to company. Like if we talk about one of the good paints company in Europe, which is a very well named, which is Akzo-Nobel, they have their own in-house banking, which they're doing via SAP. So they are more or less like a bank. They're not dependent upon an outside system, rather everything is being integrated inside, which is a pretty good example. Seriously, which is a pretty good example when I first heard about it. There are companies, without quoting the name of their size, which are maybe many times in the size of Akzo-Nobel, they have no feature what they have. So SAP Treasury and Risk Management is dependent upon the ability of the corporate treasurer, how basically he customizing it. Because you need to customize that. It is not marketing, it's not materials and distribution, sales and distribution, material management, FICO and all, which is to an extent standard. Whereby you will just put one journal entry and counter journal entry will get created, or you will tally the balance sheet, revaluation, and so on and so forth. This is how the entire structure look like. The more you move towards your left section, the more important it is. Now for a normal SAP to function. Now, first myth which you have, SAP Treasury and Risk Management, that it do covers only all activities pertaining to treasury. This is absolutely a myth, which I wanted to revoke right away. SAP Treasury and Risk Management is integrated with all modules which are in the system. But that is a different thing, that the how integration works. In the sense like, so you have seven modules, assuming of SAP on which you integrated. That doesn't mean that all seven module has to be world class, but all seven module has to be compatible as far as the SAP is concerned. That compatibility has to be there. So which is notified, which is accounts payable, which is general ledger, which is account receivable. You must be thinking, why do you need accounts payable? Why do you need general ledger? And why do you need account receivable? The reason being, let's take an example of a company, Amazon. Amazon, a company with practically need no introduction in this globe. Apple, Apple, Microsoft, Google, Facebook. These all are the companies which are working across the globe. So if you are traveling to seven cities across the globe, then in these seven countries across the globe, then in these seven countries, you will get to know you have different bifurcations. Like once you landed to Singapore, you will see that the Google Singapore, once you land to Malaysia and so on and different way. They are getting different revenue in different currencies, but at the end, all the company which I named, they have a business, they have the functional currency in dollar. So hedging is something pretty much required. One of the very important thing which people are actually missing out in SAP Treasury and Risk Management is, which I have saw in most of the companies except few, is that the hedging decision is not being taken up by the system, or the quantum is not being taken up by the system. It's being taken up by the person who is outside the system. And we are uploading this Excel file in the system to decide either we take a position or not. This is absolutely myth. In majority of the implementations of treasury and risk management, the biggest mistake which consultant is doing and companies both are doing, because companies have no right to criticize a consultant without knowing, without accepting the fact that they also do not know. They do not integrate accounts payable, general ledger and account receivable. Lot of people asking me a lot of questions, why do you need general ledger in that? My answer is that there are two sisters in accounts which always have reverse direction towards each other, but they will play very important role, which is translation and revaluation. If I talk about the five companies which I named about, Amazon, SAP, Amazon, Google, Apple, Facebook, Tesla, they are practically doing business everywhere across the globe. Since they are doing practically everywhere across the globe, their functional currency of individual countries are different, but the consolidation is happening in US dollars because they are an American setup. And here comes the translation and the revaluation on not on the individual books, but also as a standalone consolidation. So these three modules has to be pretty good. They link with the financial accounting. Majority of the times, without quoting the name of the company, but people invite you as a consultant on SAP seminars and as a consulting work. You go there and you will check it out about this. You will get to know that AR, AP and everything has been pathetically defined. Nowhere system get to know whether it's a dollar or it's a INR. There are few technical terms which I want to tell you about, like debtor reconciliation, creditors reconciliation. I'm not talking about the reconciliation. It's a term how you book the foreign exchange gain loss. Debtor reconciliation, creditors reconciliation, revaluation and translation. It's something happening arbitrarily in the system. If I tell you a name of a company, of course I will not tell in the public domain, whereby during audit, when we did the audit actually, we got to know that several assets being revalued and translated at the same point of time. How can that possible? Asset could either be translated or it could either be revalued. It cannot be both. But during audit, we got to know it is both. The reason being, FICO is in such a beautiful way that system itself do not know whether it has to revalue or it has to translate. And majority of the people also, they themselves do not know that what exactly is the implication of the revaluation. Lot of people talking revaluation is nothing but, in fact, including myself also, which is the conversion of foreign currency to local currency, which is the simplest definition of revaluation. While the simplest definition of the translation is the reverse, which is conversion of local currency to foreign currency. But the hard reality is that we have three forms of hedging in the system. Everywhere, all the five companies I name, which is cash flow hedge, which is fair value hedge, which is net investment hedge. So what is cash flow hedge, what is fair value hedge, what is net investment hedge? If I tell you that translation and revaluation have different meaning for all three, you would be surprised to know. But this is the reality. They have a different meaning for all the three. This is the hardcore reality of the life. But 99.99% times they both are configured without keeping all three into consideration. Revaluation for cash flow hedge is completely a different meaning. Revaluation for fair value hedge will completely different meaning. Like for a cash flow hedge, revaluation will go in balance sheet, which is OCI, provided hedge accounting turned true, which is one of the important role of SAP Treasury and Risk Management, hedge accounting. For a fair value hedge, revaluation will go in P&L. Either side depends the quantum of the P&L. It depends upon the sign of the revaluation. If it is a negative, it will go in debit. It will exaggerate it. It will go in the credit. So it's impact your EPS, earning per share. For a net investment hedge, we are nothing but the hedging of the consolidated translation impact of the gain. And although there are two different definitions of translation. How many times those who are watching the video, how many times you ever thought that translation and devaluation would have three different implications in the system? There are a lot of treasury management systems are applicable also, like Murex, like Calypso and different. Without quoting anybody's name in a significant way, you just need to see their systems also, either they are doing this or not. As simple as that. Then this is the thing which I specifically mentioned, which 99.99% people forget it, which is the Excel solver command unit or data mart. Now you must be thinking from where the data mart is coming into the picture. Companies like Actionable, and there are multiple companies like Amazon, Facebook and all, they are all companies, those who are managing the in-house bank, they have huge solvers in place. So from there, two places you will get the solvers. One, from a feeder, one which is system, one which you have made. Feeder stands for Reuters, Bloomberg, maybe MT4, MT5 do not have solvers, so it is Reuters and Bloomberg. Reuters itself have more than 85 solvers, 80, which in nothing but a pricer. When you have multiple pricer, you have a blotter. We are not here discussing about blotter because this is an introductory video. Now, there are companies who make their own solvers, or what they do, they will get the solvers from the banks. And this is generally which is happening. Because big companies have foreign bank on the board. Since they have foreign bank on the board, what they do, they will get the solvers from them. And this is not wrong also. Sometimes they will get directly from Reuters and Bloomberg also in the Excel, doing some little bit tweaking. This has to be connected with SAP Treasury and Risk Management. And if you are able to connect that, this is a wonderful thing which you have. In this, you would be able to take the solver oblique pricer oblique blotters. I again repeat, blotter is nothing but multiple pricer at the same point of time. If you are able to have that, you would be able to have our very good stuff in the system. Very good stuff in the system. Then here comes the two type of accounting which you are doing, which is the profit center accounting and which is the cost center accounting. If I speak from the parlance of India, 99% treasury functions are cost center. In fact, from an Indian standpoint, they should not even exist. This is a hard reality and we should appreciate that. On the contrary, when it comes to the companies like Reliance and banks like Goldman Sachs and others, they make their treasury as a profit center, and which should be. Treasury should be a profit center. It should not be a cost center. But unfortunately, it's the biggest myth we have in India. Once you make treasury as a profit center, you need to define it accordingly, like how you will book the profit, how the profits would be showing, how the system will generate. Example, you have taken a forward contract. I'm just taking a very simple example, pretty simple example. You have taken an Indian rupee, dollar to Indian rupee forward contract as 68, and you are on the sell side. And suppose Indian rupee turned out to be 62, although practically this is next to impossible, but still, what you do, you will buy here and you will sell here. In short, system should be able to tell you a gain of 6 rupee. That is how it happens. So it's up to you how you wanted a profit accounting, how you want a cost accounting. I'm not talking about a profit and cost accounting from a chartered accountant standpoint, whereby you are booking the cost and you are booking the profit. I'm here talking about SAP Treasury and Risk Management. So my definition of profit accounting and cost accounting is the system should be able to tell you what is the cost. Let it take other way. If you have a LIBOR loan, London Interbank Offer Rate in 5 currencies, you have Euribor, you have SONIA, you have SOFR, Secured Overnight Financing Rate, and multiple risk-free rate actually. And suppose you have a revolving credit, you have SPLC, a number of instruments, and you are paying an interest on that. Assume no hedging, assuming. How would you book the cost? Here we go. Then you have the main core component, SAP Treasury and Risk Management, but this component do not work unless you have this, which is the feeders. Reuters, Bloomberg, FXall is a Reuters product, TradeWeb, Reuters product, MetaTrader 4, MetaTrader 5, you have Integral FX, you have multiple products. I'm not in a situation to quote a name of a company. Recently, somewhere in Hong Kong, who invited us, and we went there also, Once I went there, I saw that they are implementing SAP Treasury Risk Management, which is quite good. Nothing wrong in that. But when I asked them, where is the feeder? You know, they said, what are we doing? We have no feeders. We are implementing RDS. Now you must be thinking RDS has not been mentioned here. I said, okay, fine. RDS stands for Reuters Data Scope Select. It's nothing but a day end messaging. So at the end of the day, you will get the message in the system and you know, so your system will automatically get revaluation or translated. So it depends actually. I said, boss, you do not have a RDS. You have RDS, but you do not have the feeder. You know what is the mistake you're doing and you don't trust me. This client is a pretty big client and they have having all kind of exposures like swaps, options and so on and so forth. I still fail to understand from where they will get the live pricing, but they still adamant that they will do on the RDS. So they will take 3 times RDS in a day as per their Hong Kong timings. So 3 times RDS and they are going to be deciding their pricing. Who knows? So the moral of the story, SAP Treasury and Risk Management cannot be work unless you have the feeders. And if your mindset is that the only one feeder will work, then this mindset is absolutely incorrect, because you need to have multiple feeders in place. Bloomberg is having a specialty, Reuters having a specialty, FX All, Integral FX, they all used to bid and ask, basically the order. This is nothing but the order management systems. They're being used whereby even you need the accuracy of the one basis point, because the orders are quite big and so orders are quite big and so on and so forth. At the end, you need a system called trade reporting and position management. This is a very important thing. In this trade reporting and position management, you need to have a system which is directly integrated. Here you need a direct integration with RDS, which is Reuters Data Scope Select. So that what happening in the trade reporting and position management, there are three things actually. One is the live position management, the outstanding positions, the mark to market, the net present value and hedge accounting and so on and so forth. Another thing is TTM, trailing 12 months, LTM last 12 months, and there are multiple compositions. Last but not the least, you have trade lifecycle management, you have settlement lifecycle management, all these will come under here. This is how about an architecture of SAP Treasury and Risk Management will work. I again repeat, feeders play a very important role, but unfortunately they are always taken at granted, and this is how it works. It's not easy to set up. It requires an effort, it requires a time, it requires money, it requires high skill set. If you do not have that, unfortunate. In case you have any questions, my email is rahul.magan@treasuryconsulting.in. Skype rahul5327. Platform is www.fixedincome.global. Website is www.treasuryconsulting.in. Mobile 9899242978. 9899242978. Last but not the least, this is just the start of the game. There are so many videos on the way. Have a great time ahead. Enjoy your day. Thank you.